There's a scene in the British comedy Monty Python and the Holy Grail that, as well as being funny, also introduces some quite central questions about politics. King Arthur is on a quest through his realm and comes across a pair of annoying peasants who ask a very annoying question.
Old woman!
Man!
Ma'am, sorry. What knight lives in that castle over there?
I'm 37.
What?
I'm 37. I'm not old.
Well, I can't just call you man.
You could say Dennis.
I didn't know you were called Dennis.
Well, you didn't bother to find out, did you?
I did say sorry about the old woman, but from behind you looked...
What I object to is you automatically treat me like an inferior.
Well, I am king.
Oh, king, eh? Very nice. And how'd you get that, eh? By exploiting the workers. By hanging on to outdated imperialist dogma, which perpetuates the economic and social differences in our society. If there's ever going to be any progress...
Dennis, there's some lovely filth down here. Oh, how'd you do?
How'd you do, good lady? I'm Arthur, King of the Britons. Whose castle is that?
King of the who?
The Britons.
Who are the Britons?
Well, we all are. We are all Britons. And I am your king.
Oh, didn't know we had a king. I thought we were an autonomous collective.
You're fooling yourself. We're living in a dictatorship. A self-perpetuating autocracy in which the working classes...
Oh, there you go, bringing class into it again.
Well, that's what it's all about. If only people would...
Please, please, good people. I am in haste. Who lives in that castle?
No one lives there.
Then who is your lord?
We don't have a lord.
What?
I told you, we're an anarcho-syndicalist commune. We take it in turns to act as a sort of executive officer for the week.
Yes.
But all the decisions of that officer have to be ratified at a special bi-weekly meeting.
Yes, I see.
By a simple majority in the case of purely internal affairs.
Be quiet.
But by a two-thirds majority in the case of more...
Be quiet. I order you to be quiet.
Order? Who does he think he is?
I'm your king.
Well, I didn't vote for you.
You don't vote for kings?
Well, how'd you become king, then?
The Lady of the Lake. Her arm clad in the purest shimmering samite, held aloft Excalibur from the bosom of the water, signifying by divine providence that I, Arthur, was to carry Excalibur. That is why I'm your king.
Listen, strange women lying in ponds distributing swords is no basis for a system of government. Supreme executive power derives from a mandate from the masses, not from some farcical aquatic ceremony.
Be quiet!
Oh, but you can't expect to wield supreme executive power just because some watery tart threw a sword at you.
Shut up!
Oh, but if I went round saying I was an emperor just because some moistened bint had lobbed a scimitar at me, they'd put me away.
Shut up! Will you shut up?
Ah, now we see the violence inherent in the system.
Shut up!
Oh, come and see the violence inherent in the system! Help! Help! I'm being repressed!
Bloody peasant!
Oh, what a giveaway. Did you hear that? Did you hear that, eh? That's what I'm on about. Did you see him repressing me? You saw it, didn't you?
How did you get to be king, then, eh? That might be seen as simply a question about events. What happened? What happened to make you king? But it's also a question of rights. How come you get to tell us what to do? Fundamentally, this is the question of political legitimacy. What gives a king or any leader or government the right to rule over others? We in the West, and now in lots of other places, have arrived fairly securely at one decisive answer to that question. A leader or government gets its right to rule from the consent of the governed. A mandate from the masses, as Dennis, the annoying peasant, tells us. That phrase actually is there, many of you will recognize, in the United States Declaration of Independence. It says, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, and that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed." This is what is known in political theory as the idea of a social contract, the idea that a legitimate government is one in which the citizens have implicitly or explicitly entered into some kind of agreement with each other and with their leader to be governed for their mutual benefit. The idea of the social contract is really what starts off modern political theory as we know it. From next week on, we're going to be looking at the idea of the social contract as it develops through history and through different political thinkers and different political events. The consent of the governed doesn't necessarily mean democracy. You can consent to be ruled by a government without necessarily choosing that government. But it was from the idea of the social contract that our modern democratic ideas emerged. The best way of ensuring the consent of the masses, it came to be thought, was to let them choose. Democracy has now spread over much of the world. This is the Economist Intelligence Unit, which produces an index every year of the state of world democracies, with different shades of green colors showing democracies, and then oranges and reds for authoritarian regimes, and then yellow in the middle for a mixture of the two. And there are more green countries here than orange or red or yellow. So it seems democracy has won out for now. But taking political history as a whole, democracy is really incredibly rare. Just 30 years ago, this map would have looked very different. And democracy might not last. There's nothing inevitable about it. It's common to hear cynical talk said with varying degrees of seriousness that the outcome of such and such an election is in itself an argument against democracy. You might hear that this guy is himself an argument against democracy. Or this guy. Do we take that too seriously? Perhaps not. What about this guy? He won an election in 1933. I'm curious to know how absolute your own faith in democracy is, if you have any at all. Is it always the single deciding factor in whether or not you believe a government is legitimate, if you believe a government to be worthy of obeying and abiding by? Are you always obliged to obey the law if it's made by a democratically elected government? Can you imagine any situation where it would be necessary to work to overthrow a democratically elected government? You tell me.